if you track women through their ovulation cycle and you show them a picture of a man, same man, and you do nothing but vary his jaw width, when they're ovulating, the guy with the wider jaw is more attractive, and when they're not ovulating, the farthest away from that, the guy with the thinner jaw is more attractive, and that's associated with testosterone levels. And so women who are fertile like more masculine men, and basically if you're on the pill, then you're never in that ovulation phase. And so one thing that may have happened, and I don't know this for sure, but it's interesting to consider, is that since women have been taking the birth control pill, their preference for less masculine men has become more pronounced. And that could easily be one of the things that's fueling at least some of the tension that's existed and exists now politically between men and women. But the point is that you just cannot ignore the massive consequences of a biological revolution like that. And to make any other factor causal when you're trying to understand the political movements, especially in the last, say, 40 years, you're putting the cart before the horse. Now, it's reasonable to point out that the pill wouldn't have been accepted as a technology if certain political changes with regards to the emancipation of women hadn't already been in place, right? No one would have even been allowed to do something like investigate contraception. So you can't separate the biological from the political entirely, but it's still very useful to organizing your thinking to realize just how profound a revolution that was. But now, back in the Victorian times, see, there's another thing about sexuality. Modern people like to think that there's nothing dangerous about sex, and that is like the stupidest thing you could possibly ever hypothesize, because everything about it is dangerous. It's dangerous emotionally, it's dangerous socially, it's dangerous because of the possibility of unwanted pregnancy, and it's dangerous because of the possibility of sickness, and that's a major one. I mean, so when AIDS emerged in the 1980s, that could have easily killed all of us. Now, the fact that it didn't was wonderful, but it did kill hundreds of millions of people. So it was no joke. It was a big deal. And AIDS mutated to take advantage of promiscuity. And so the relationship between sexual behavior and the transmission of disease is actually mediated at the biological level. But anyways, back in the 1890s, they had the same problem, right? They had the problem with syphilis. And syphilis is one nasty disease. It can mimic almost any other disease, and it's devastating to your nervous system, and you can pass it on to your children. And so part of the reason that sexuality was heavily repressed in the Victorian period was not only because of the possibility of unwanted pregnancy, the relative poverty of people. You know, back in 1895 in Europe, the average person lived on less than a dollar a day in modern terms. You know, it's almost impossible to understand how poor people were. And so sex in a poverty-stricken place is also a lot more dangerous than it is in a rich place, because especially given the lack of employment opportunities for women back in the Victorian period, if you happened to get pregnant out of wedlock, you were in serious trouble. And so the fact that sexuality was repressed is hardly a surprise, because it was so difficult to integrate into the full-fledged personality, you know, and as it still is. So sexual repression, supposedly characteristic feature of the Victorian period, was often merely the expression of two facts: the lack of diffusion of contraceptives and the fear of venereal disease. It was all the more dangerous because of the great spread of prostitution, and because prostitutes were almost invariably contaminated and therefore potential sources of infection. We can hardly imagine today how monstrous syphilis appeared to people of that time. Well, we can imagine it a little bit better than they could in 1970, because it hasn't, you know, AIDS is still with us, although it's nowhere near the plague that it was, say, 25 years ago.